here, and maybe
use that quick.
Well, I need as many options as I can get.
You think you're supposed to be there?
Well, I'm gonna stay. I'm gonna kind of sit down so I can do this stuff. And I'll just put it back in there when I'm kind of
let him do it.
Why don't you do it? Yeah, let me. it's the only I have to do on. Okay, as we said, we're trying to keep this thing better and bigger and better every year, and I'm very excited to have Mike Nunn back. And we have Craig Jones this year from South Carolina DNR. If you want to go to your materials, as you know, Major Nunn was here last year, and he's originally from Columbia, and he earned his undergraduate law degree from University of South Carolina, both of them. He's a senior litigator at Aikens Bridges in Florence, and for 27 years, his primary focus was on Med-Mal, products liability, government torts, and liability defense. And that may be a future topic here, some type of liability. He's a fellow at the American Board of Trial Attorneys, and as a lot of you know, the minimum requirement is 100 jury trials, which is, that's a big deal. He became a reserve deputy with the Florence County Sheriff's Office in 2006, and then he left private practice to become the position of General Counsel and Public Information Officer with the Sheriff's Office. With the rank of major, he's a graduate of the South Carolina Criminal Justice Academy, which, by the way, the brag on myself here a little bit, the book is now in the South Carolina Justice Academy, so I'm excited about that. Anyway, he's a class one police officer involved in all aspects of the sheriff's office operations, including enforcement, investigations, narcotics, and SWAT. He's a member of the National Criminal Enforcement Association and feature writer for the association's nationally publicized magazine, Criminal Enforcement. Frequent speaker and lecturer on topics affecting law enforcement. He's also an NRA certified firearms instructor and a SLED certified CWP instructor. Now, the one thing he doesn't put in here that I found out over the last year was that he was on the Miracle on the Hudson flight with Captain Sully, and he told us the whole story about how he went through that. So if you ever want to hear it from a firsthand, probably can't use too much of the time here for that, but it's probably the most interesting thing you'll hear in a long time. And okay, and then he was able, I credit Mike, was able to get us Craig Jones, who a lot of you already know in here, but he's with the South Carolina DNR. He's a native of Sumter County and the son of a 35-year retired law enforcement officer. He's a 94 graduate of the Citadel, and he served as 2 years deputy with the Sumter County Sheriff's Office and 4 years with Charleston County Sheriff's Office. By the way, Sheriff Cannon is usually here. He never misses this, but he's got the flu today, so he wanted to say hi to everybody and say he felt bad he couldn't be here. And get back to this, Craig is also a criminal justice lecturer at the Charleston School of Law. His experience includes the Town of Folly Beach Prosecutor, Police Benevolent Association, Defense Counsel, Fraternal Order of Police Defense Counsel, and had a general criminal practice until 2013. His current position is Assistant Chief Counsel with South Carolina Department of Natural Resources, Natural, with a primary focus on criminal prosecution, training, and other criminal-related matters. His position is statewide, and he resides in Charleston. He's married and has two daughters. All right.
Take it away, guys. You can use that. He'll use
that. Yeah.
Yeah, he's okay.
Can you hear this? Is that getting out over this microphone? Good. Well, good afternoon, and I want to thank Steve for allowing us to be a part of this great seminar. I've enjoyed it. I've been coming to it for years and been honored to have spoken last year and be invited to come back. Heard Henry earlier say he didn't know which was more fun, coming to this seminar or going to the gun show, and I kind of agree with that, and I was going to suggest to Steve that maybe next time we could combine the two. When Steve got up with me earlier this year and said, what can we do on the program, he said, I'd like to try to incorporate how law enforcement interacts with citizens and individuals possessing firearms. And thought, great, we can certainly do that. There's an approach by traditional law enforcement, like whom I work for, on routine stops and daily activity. And then there's DNR. We encounter firearms in traditional law enforcement on a much less basis than others, whereas Craig's officers, it's almost a presumption. When they encounter someone out in the field, they're going to be armed. So there's a little bit of a different approach there, and we want to try and play that off, and I think it makes for some interesting comparison. So we're going to discuss firearms laws in general, law enforcement approach to firearms, and see where we go from there. You know, there was a time when it was rare when law enforcement had a gun call. And what I call that is a gun call is where you're dispatched to a location and there's at least the allegation or the suspicion that a gun's involved. That used to be pretty rare. I can tell you now from working on patrol, there's at least one gun call every night. And so there's been a significant proliferation of those types of calls, and law enforcement has had to develop the ability to deal with those. So we're going to discuss a little bit about that. So law enforcement as a whole strongly supports the Second Amendment, and I can certainly speak for my sheriff, who is a very stalwart advocate for the right to carry, and takes the position that law enforcement has nothing to fear from law-abiding citizens possessing firearms in almost any circumstance, even with encounters with law enforcement. So we start from that perspective. And when you look at it, guns are all, they're pretty much part of our national DNA. And you look back to the founding, and certainly Stephen was speaking about this, I'm sure his books demonstrate this in spades, but there's something about our nation where the ability to defend oneself is kind of in our DNA. It's a quote from George Washington, free people ought not only be armed and disciplined, but they should have sufficient arms and ammunition to maintain a state of independence from any who might attempt to abuse them, which would include their own government. Somebody else who knew a little bit about freedom, Thomas Jefferson. Laws that forbid the carrying of firearms disarm only those who are neither inclined nor determined to commit crimes. Such laws make things worse for the assaulted and better for the assailants. They serve rather to encourage than prevent homicides, for an unarmed man may be attacked with greater confidence than an armed man. So all of this was borne out in our Second Amendment. A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. It's amazing how a constitutional right written out, number two on the list, somehow or another gets short shrift. And yet, our courts are very easily led to read rights into our Constitution which are written nowhere. Makes you wonder. Okay? So, we actually had to go to court and have the guy here in the room who's a part of that. Second Amendment is now an individual right after District of Columbia versus Heller. The right to keep and bear arms protects an individual right to self-defense in the home, which cannot be abridged, according to McDonald versus Chicago. And the Second Amendment created a right of self-defense outside the home as well as inside. The case of Moore versus Madigan, which overturned the Illinois no carry under any conditions law. So, I think what these we're getting back to is a recognition that we are our own first line of defense. That old adage, when seconds count, the police are only minutes away, is never more true. And if you look at even the average active shooter situation, the average active shooter scenario lasts 4 to 5 minutes and is resolved in typically one of two ways, with the assailant being killed by first armed resistance or killing himself when encountering that first armed resistance. The police are still suiting up by the time this is usually over. So we are our own first line of defense. So under federal law, has been discussed, who cannot own or possess firearms under federal law? Actually, the Constitution gives us this right, but the federal government says the following persons cannot possess firearms: persons who've renounced their U.S. citizens, persons dishonorably discharged from the military, persons convicted of felonies and some misdemeanors, narcotics addicts, anyone adjudicated by a court of mental illness, illegal aliens, although registered legal aliens can own firearms, and persons convicted of misdemeanor CDVs in certain circumstances. Okay? In addition, the Youth Handgun Safety Act makes it unlawful to sell, deliver, or otherwise transfer to a juvenile, that's anyone under 18 years of age under federal law, a handgun or ammunition suitable only for a handgun. It's further unlawful for a juvenile to possess the handgun or ammunition suitable only for a handgun. Think about a 22 long rifle. Well, that'll go in a rifle and it'll go in a handgun, so probably doesn't apply. Okay? The exceptions for these are many, but one of the most notable ones is the juvenile engaged in ranching, farming, or with written consent of a parent, a juvenile member of the armed forces. So, under South Carolina law, who can own or possess a firearm? Well, if you're 18 years of age in South Carolina, you are considered an adult for all purposes, with the exception of the purchase of alcohol. So, at 18, you can possess, own a rifle, a shotgun, and a handgun. Now, an 18-year-old may be given, inherit, or purchase a handgun from a private party, but federal law prohibits the purchase of a handgun or handgun ammunition by anyone from an FFL by anyone under the age of 21. So if you're going to buy it from Academy Sports, you've got to be 21. You can buy it from a private individual, you can buy it, or you can inherit it from a relative or be given it between the ages of 18 and 21. So, not advancing. Get ahead of myself here. Okay, so let's look at the South Carolina law concerning the carrying of handguns, section 162320. And it's the general law which basically is a blanket prohibition. You can't, you cannot, and it is unlawful for anyone to carry about the person any handgun, whether concealed or open, within certain exceptions. So we've got, you can't carry it except under these circumstances. And you're going to see in a minute why there's a big paradigm shift here. Without a permit, you still can carry in the home or on real estate owned by you or with permission of an owner in a vehicle if it's in a closed glove compartment, trunk, or console. And concealed weapons permit holders may have it under the seat or in any compartment inside the vehicle. You can carry a handgun while moving from one residence to another if it is unloaded. In a fixed place of business, the owner can carry concealed or open, and employees with permission of the owner can do so with a CWP. Licensed hunters or fishermen engaged in hunting or fishing, going to and from hunting or fishing in a vehicle or on foot. Now, Craig can comment on this later, but you know, we've got this 18-year-old prohibition. An 18-year-old can possess a handgun under South Carolina law. But you have to have a license to hunt after you're 16, right?
Yeah, 16 and 18, our agency says if you're carrying a firearm in the commission of hunting, we're not going to, you're fine. You do it. As long as you're licensed hunting, you're in the act of hunting, you can carry a handgun.
All right. So there's a little age discrepancy there. Licensed hunters and fishermen while engaged in hunting or fishing, going to and from hunting or fishing in a vehicle or on foot can possess firearms. Okay? So also on a motorcycle when secured in a closed saddlebag or other container. Then in 1996, we experienced a paradigm shift in South Carolina, which at that time allowed for the issuance of concealed weapons permits. So as opposed to the old law, which prohibited all of this but carved out certain exceptions, the Law Abiding Citizens Act, Self-Defense Act of 1996 basically said if you go through this course and you obtain this permit, you can carry pretty much anywhere except the following locations. So it made a complete shift in the view, okay? So again, for the first time in South Carolina, this act allowed ordinary citizens over the age of 21 to obtain a permit after training and a criminal background check to carry concealed handguns nearly anywhere. The exceptions are federal, state, governmental buildings, schools or colleges, posted private property, houses of worship, private residence of others, hospitals, medical clinics, doctor's offices, among others. It still left prohibitions with or without a permit, which include it's illegal to carry on any mode of public transportation. It's illegal to carry in bars and restaurants which sell alcohol unless you're a CWP holder and you do not consume. That was recently changed by the legislature, which finally got it that number one, concealed weapons permit holders probably commit less crime on a percentage basis than police officers, and that there's really no reason to prevent them from carrying in Applebee's just because it has a on-premises consumption permit. And finally the compromise was, well, okay, we'll let them in as long as they don't drink. So that's where the legislature finally came down on that. All right, it's illegal to carry where your employer prohibits concealable weapons on your premises. And that was interesting. That's been discussed earlier. I think that's going to be a topic of debate going forward. You know, basically, if your employer considers his premises to be his parking lot where you have to park, he's basically disarmed you from the time you leave your home until the time you get back. So I think the legislature may be in the process of addressing that. Some other states have done that. I can tell you that Utah says if your employer prohibits you from doing that, they have to provide you alternative parking at their expense. So there are all kind of ways to skin that cat, and other states have done so. So it'll be interesting to see what South Carolina does about that. All right, it's illegal to carry into the home of another without permission. I think that's pretty self-explanatory. And it's illegal to carry on school premises unless you have a CWP locked in your glove compartment or trunk. Now, certainly many of these are subject to permission from the authority in that location. I know in houses of worship, if you get the permission of the governing body of the church or the pastor, you can carry inside houses of worship. Same thing with schools. Should be noted that those foregoing exceptions apply to handguns and not necessarily long guns or shotguns. There's generally no specific prohibition against possessing and carrying of long guns in the home, in the vehicle, or in public. Of course, unlawful carrying of a firearm in South Carolina is a misdemeanor, punishable by not less than 30 days nor more than 90. And a fine of between $200 and $500 or both. If you're a CWP holder and are convicted of that, you can have your permit revoked for 5 years. In addition, under that statute, your firearm must be forfeited to the arresting jurisdiction. So, with that background, let's talk a little bit about traditional encounters that law enforcement would have with firearms. And from our standpoint, unlike Craig's officers, ours are not usual, but they're increasingly more and more common. So some of the areas where we encounter firearms with citizens, traffic stops, and I'll include street encounters with that same analysis, search warrants, calls for service, especially in domestics and traffic safety checkpoints. Now, let me first say that law enforcement officers are typically 21 years of age or older. Minimum requirements is a high school degree. Some have a degree from Tech. Some of them have college degrees. But we send them to the South Carolina Criminal Justice Academy for 12 weeks. They graduate, they come home to their agency, have 8 weeks of field training. We give them a gun and a badge and we tell them, now go out there and practice constitutional law, but don't violate anybody's rights. And oh, by the way, make sure you go home safe at night. Pretty daunting task. We're asking a lot of these folks. All of us are either lawyers or judges in this room, have much more training than that, but I can tell you, especially with the experienced officers, they do a marvelous job of this, and I have tremendous respect for them. Their experience on the street and their ability to balance this stuff, it sometimes overwhelms me. And it's my privilege to be associated with them. And I know from doing the same things on patrol, I know what they come in contact with, and I know what they have to deal with on a daily basis. So they have my profound respect in doing that. But we do have to remember that there are some limitations. So there are two kinds of traffic stops, known risk and unknown risk. The known risk is where the law enforcement officer knows the subject is likely armed and dangerous, and specific tactics are deployed for the use in that stop. That's where we know the vehicle is stolen. That's when we know there's a warrant for this person, that they're armed or they've just committed a crime and we're getting ready to stop them. It's sometimes referred to as a felony stop. And we certainly want more than one officer involved in that stop. The other kind of stop is every other stop, which is called unknown risk. Law enforcement officer has no specific knowledge of the subject beyond the reason for which he's being stopped, but must be prepared immediately to respond to any threat. Now, this type of stop usually for traffic violations or something else, and often involves only one officer. But where there is a street encounter with more than one officer is designated the contact officer, and that officer conducts the interaction with the subject vehicle operator or passengers, and depending upon the circumstances, may ask if there are any weapons present. The other officer is called a cover officer, who, from a triangulated position, observes the subjects, observes the vehicle, and anyone else approaching, paying close attention to hands and waistbands, because that's where the trouble comes from. So the cover officer is there to assist and react in the event there's some problem while the contact officer is conducting business. So, South Carolina concealed weapons permit law requires that someone carrying, pursuant to the statute, with a permit, has certain duties and responsibilities when contacted by law enforcement. When carrying concealed weapon pursuant to the CWP statute, a permit holder must inform the law enforcement officer of the fact that he's a permit holder and present the permit when the officer, number one, identifies himself or is identified as a law enforcement officer, and two, requests either their driver's license or identification. Okay? Passengers in the vehicle do not have to disclose that they are carrying pursuant to the CWP statute unless the officer asks for their identification. Okay? So, what's the proper interaction with a police officer on a traffic stop? So, you're driving along and you look up in your mirror and those blue lights are for you. What do we do? These are suggestions. This is not the required by statute or anything, but I think they're good common sense suggestions for you and your clients. Drive your vehicle to the first safe place completely off of the roadway. If it's at night, cut on your dome light so that the officer can see you and who else may be inside the vehicle. Place your hands on the steering wheel where they're clearly visible by the officer. When asked for your license or registration, disclose your CWP if you have one. The officer will probably ask, where's the weapon located? Tell him. Listen carefully to the instructions and follow those instructions. And don't make any sudden moves toward the location of the weapon unless instructed. And I can tell you from someone who conducts traffic stops and has encountered individuals carrying firearms, both with and without a concealed weapons permit, when I stop somebody and they say, I've got a concealed weapon and a permit, my anxiety level on that stop just went down. Just went down. Because I know I've got somebody here that is complying with the law. They've told me they've got the permit and they've told me they got the weapon. I'm not going to be surprised by anything. This person's been through training. They've been through a background check by SLED. And so the chances of me having a problem here are really, really low. I'm not going to ask to see the weapon. I figure the less gun handling on a traffic stop, the better. If that permit's good, I'm okay with them keeping it right where it is. If they, I'll get your question in just a second. If they tell me that it's in the glove compartment, well, first of all, if it's simply in the glove compartment, they're not carrying pursuant to the statute. So they really don't even have to disclose that. But it's a good idea to do that. But if they have to go someplace close to where the weapon is located, I might alter my process a little bit. So in other words, if the registration is someplace where the gun's located, or they've got to go somewhere in their on their person to get a document, I might try to check that license through dispatch to see if it's valid. I might run the numbers or the name and date of birth through dispatch to see if the license is valid. I don't necessarily need them reaching around for this stuff. Makes them nervous, makes us nervous, but we can sometimes find a way around having them actually handle the gun. And I can remove them from the vehicle. I can ask them to step out so that they're separated from it while we conduct business. So there are all kind of ways to skin this cat if as long as everybody's cooperating. Now, again, this is not statutorily required, but it's just common sense. There are instances, especially with females, who may not be comfortable stopping in a dark, lonely place for the blue light. We get that. All about it. We want you to be comfortable. So if it's at night, and you're not comfortable stopping in a particular dark or desolate area, think about the following. Number one, slow down to below the speed limit. Number two, cut on your dome light. Let's see what's going on in there. Cut on your emergency flashers, acknowledging the police officer's blue lights. And if you wish, call 911 and request that the officer on that call be notified that you're traveling to a well-lighted area, because the officers call that call in to dispatch. And he's telling them, I'm getting ready to stop this vehicle, so they know. And then the dispatch can say, the vehicle you're getting ready to stop just called in. They want to go to a better location, so they're going to stop at the first well-lighted location that appears to be safe. We've got no problem with that. Welcome that all the time, because chances are a safe location for you, it's a safe location for us. The better lighted, the better for everyone. So that's something else that that you can consider. I had a question over here, sir.
My question was the procedure when you inform the officer that you've got a CWP. I've seen what they ask you to do then differently. Some want to see the gun, some say leave the gun. Where is the gun?
The question is, there are different tactics used by officers after disclosure that you've got the CWP and you've got the weapon. Some want to see it. See the weapon, somewhere want to know where it's located, and those types of things. In almost all circumstances, my officers aren't going to ask you to show them the weapon. You know, maybe there are some of the jurisdictions that do. But again, the less gun handling on the traffic stop, the better. And what we promise folks is, you don't handle your gun, I won't handle mine. So we'll all go home safely. But I guess they do it different in different locations. And I've been aware that there's some jurisdictions who want to see that, and they're going to want to run the serial number through NCIC. I can tell you again, I don't want to handle that gun. I'm not interested in it. If you're a legal CWP holder, I've got no real basis to run the serial number on that weapon.
Well, often your registration is off. If you aren't carrying a gun, it's in the glove box.
That's right.
Registration's in the glove box.
That's right. And that's an occasion where I would say, that's fine, thank you for disclosing that. I'd run the tag through dispatch and see if the tag's good. Nobody has to go to the gun.
And just to jump in, I mean, sometimes the officer at that time, you know, our guys, like I said, I get out in the field not as much, but they may ask you to step out, and they may just step around and say, do you mind if I'm going to reach in here? And is your registration, where is it at? Is it in a pouch? Is it? They may secure the gun for a moment while you go in there if it's, you know, a mess and they can't find it. So there's not a one approach to it. The officer's going to do kind of the way that they feel the situation best leaves them in a position where they feel comfortable and you feel comfortable. And typically, once they get their stuff, they're going to place it right back in that glove box, shut it back up, tell you have a nice day, do whatever they need to do. But there isn't an academy really a taught approach on each and every one like that. So it may be different from one officer to another, maybe kind of what comfort level they're at. Time of night may depend on how many traffic, how many other officers are present. If there's another officer there, they may have them step around. They may say, hey, go in there and grab it. Flip your gun over, and it just depends. But there is not a set approach on that. That helps.
Thank you, Craig. That's exactly right. And on occasion, when I've done an actual a passenger side approach to a vehicle, meaning I'm talking to the driver across the through the passenger window, which I've probably done because traffic on the left side of the vehicle. If they say that the registration is in the glove box, and along with the weapon, I'll ask them, do you mind if I go in there and get that? And most of them say no, by all means. And I'll remove the weapon, put it on the roof, and then get the registration. We'll run it. When we're done with business, I'll take it back, put it in the glove box, shut it up, and we're good to go. Okay. Now, what if you're not a CWP holder? Well, if you're not, you're still legally allowed to carry a handgun, or really any gun, in the vehicle. Handgun can be in the glove box, in the console, or in the trunk. Okay? And if it's in any of those places, you really don't have to disclose that to the police officer. Now, I advise that you do, because the last thing we want is to be surprised by the presence of a weapon on that traffic stop. But again, it's up to you. There's nothing statutorily that requires you to disclose that. It's just good common sense for everybody. Okay? And it shows you're cooperating with the officer, and usually that works well. And from our agency standpoint, we try and arrest as few people as we possibly can. As a matter of fact, if you're stopped on a traffic violation and you get arrested by our agency, well, you pretty much earned that. You worked for it hard, and yeah, we'll reward it. But for the most part, we're much more happy when we can issue a warning as opposed to a citation. Now, in appropriate cases, we'll do that. But a lot of times, your outcome is dependent directly upon your attitude, okay? So, when and under what circumstances can a law enforcement officer conduct a pat search for weapons? Well, South Carolina Supreme Court says that because of the indisputable nexus between drugs and guns, where a police officer has reasonable suspicions that drugs are present in a vehicle lawfully stopped, there's an appropriate level of criminal activity to justify a frisk of the driver and the passenger for weapons. Just that nexus. So if I walk up to the vehicle and I can smell marijuana, there's a drug connection. There's an indisputable nexus, according to our South Carolina Supreme Court, and that alone would allow me to frisk the passenger and the occupants for weapons at that time. Not only the state of South Carolina has recognized that, but also the Fourth Circuit, which says because of, again, that's the same phraseology, the indisputable nexus between drugs and guns presumptively creates reasonable suspicion to an officer. So, having said that, that nexus does not apply across the board. If I stop you for driving under the influence, I smell alcohol instead of marijuana, there's not such an indisputable connection between guns and alcohol that would allow me on that basis alone to conduct a frisk for weapons. Absent some other articulation of danger in that scenario, I'm not authorized to do a pat-down frisk according to South Carolina law. So it's that drug nexus and any other articulable circumstances that the officer can articulate. All right, so in U.S. v. Black, it's a Fourth Circuit case, rose out of North Carolina, where carrying open is permitted. Actually, North Carolina has not a lot of people know this, but North Carolina has a pretty decent open carry law. And so in Black, Black was convicted of being a felon in possession of a firearm. He was patted down after he was found to possess that gun, and he had his he was convicted under federal statute. The federal court threw that out, saying basically, being a felon in possession of a firearm is not a default status. More importantly, where a state permits individuals to openly carry firearms, the exercise of that right without more cannot justify an investigatory detention. Then, in 2016, in the case of U.S. v. Robinson, the same Fourth Circuit decided a case. It threw out another conviction of an individual for possessing a firearm under a federal statute, convicted felon. And the facts are this. The police received an anonymous tip that they had seen an African-American male load and place a firearm in his pocket. Later got into in a parking lot of a convenience store near a high crime area. So the police were close by. They saw a vehicle traveling, stopped the vehicle based on seatbelt violations of both the passenger and the driver. Now, the passenger was the individual suspected of being of having the gun. So they got the driver out of the vehicle. Backup officer arrives, gets the suspect out of the vehicle, and says, hey, do you have any weapons on you? And the court described the individual's behavior as a strange look. He actually didn't say anything. He just gave a strange look. And at that point, the officer began to pat him down, found the weapon. Subsequently, it was determined that the individual was a convicted felon. He was charged and pled guilty to the weapons violations with the right to appeal. So he appeals to the Fourth Circuit. The Fourth Circuit reverses the conviction, saying that the officer had to base his decision to frisk on what he knew at the time. And at the time, he suspected that the individual might be armed, but he had no reason to know that he was a convicted felon. So armed does not necessarily mean armed and dangerous to justify the Terry frisk. And in that case, the court had some interesting language. And it's almost as if it were chastising the state for its liberal gun policies. It says, we recognize that expanded rights to openly carry or conceal guns in public may give rise to genuine safety concerns on the part of police officers, who more often will find themselves confronting individuals who may be armed. But where a sovereign state has made, and this was West Virginia, by the way, has made its judgment that its citizens may safely arm themselves in public, we cannot presume that public gun possession gives rise to reasonable suspicion. Okay, so basically the court saying, hey, West Virginia, you created this, deal with it. Okay? This case was actually in my materials, and less than a month ago, U.S. v. Robinson was reversed by an en banc hearing in the Fourth Circuit. And the Fourth Circuit said, the officer who makes a lawful stop and has reasonable suspicion an occupant is armed, may frisk for officer safety. They said it's inconsequential that the passenger may have a permit to carry a concealed firearm. The danger justifying the frisk arises from a combination of forced police encounters and the presence of a weapon, not from its illegality. Pretty amazing. So basically what they said was, armed and dangerous might just be read as armed. Maybe the armed part justifies the dangerous. The law presumes the gun is always dangerous. Whether lawfully or unlawfully carried, guns pose a risk of danger to the public and law officers. This is the Fourth Circuit speaking. And individuals who choose to carry firearms may sacrifice certain constitutional protections afforded those who elect not to carry. Pretty amazing. Okay? So, that's a very recent decision from the Fourth Circuit. Where it might go from there, whether it's going to be appealed further, can't tell you. Now, with regard to officer safety, let me show you just how easily it is to conceal a firearm. This isn't some garage-made firearm device. This is actually a production by a firearms company designed to be concealed to look like a cell phone, pretty much like the one I've got on my belt right now. These are the types of things that our officers are encountering on a daily basis. Here's another example. That's another cell phone gun. So it's not always obvious, even with a terry pat, that I guarantee you no officer is going to discover either one of those on a terry frisk. Why? Doesn't look like a gun, doesn't feel like a gun, but it's a gun. So there are real life safety concerns out there that rub up against the constitutional rights too. So we're constantly trying to find that balance between public safety and civil liberties. All right, final word on guns and traffic stops. Again, the less gun handling, the better as far as we're concerned. Without reasonable suspicion, there's no basis to run a weapon through NCIC to see if it's stolen or not. Give driver and passenger specific instructions if the presence of gun is discovered. It's disclosed. We'll try to physically separate the driver from the gun by asking them to step out of the vehicle if necessary. And we'll try to run the registration through dispatch if the gun's located in the glove compartment. So we're going to do our best to make that encounter as pleasant and as swift and as safe as we can to complete that task and move on. All right? So that's the traffic stop street encounter. Any questions about those? All right, let's move on to another area, another law enforcement activity where guns can potentially be encountered. Question back here.
For permit holders, you said you had the compartment closed. Does it have to be closed for a permit holder?
No. As a matter of fact, I think under the new law, any compartment that is made by the manufacturer. As a matter of fact, in the side door pocket, I think is an acceptable place for a concealed weapons permit holder to have the weapon under the seat. I'm not sure the compartment needs to be closed.
It needs to be secured if it's under the seat, though.
Correct.
It's an operative word, right?
Correct. That's correct. Okay? All right, so we've got a valid search warrant to search premises based on probable cause that a crime's been committed and evidence of the crime is located in the place we want to search. It's been signed off by a neutral and detached magistrate based upon probable cause. That basically gives us absolute control of those premises, and we cannot permit any interference or resistance to that. It's judicially ordered. That carries implicit authority to detain occupants during the search and to conduct protective sweeps of the premises to ensure that there are no other Confederates or others in the area that might pose an officer safety risk. We can take reasonable steps for officer safety, including pat down for weapons in the premises if we reasonably suspect individuals may have them. And in a drug warrant, that's exactly what we're going to do. Because again, there's that indisputable nexus between drugs and firearms. Okay? Now, that does not come without certain reasonableness standards. And the common law knock and announce principle clearly forms a part of the inquiry under the Fourth Amendment as to whether or not that search is reasonable. The knock and announce rationale is that it allows the individual to peacefully comply with the lawful authorities, gives them time to respond, and is for everyone's safety and to avoid the destruction of property, protection of dignity and privacy. If police come while you're in the shower, you ought to be given a reasonable opportunity to respond, and so that you know that the transaction can take place with as much dignity as possible. Now, having said that, no-knock warrants can be justified if knocking and announcing would be dangerous or futile or inhibit the investigation, i.e. the destruction of evidence. The no-knock warrant must come from the judicial authority based on the articulation of facts justifying that no-knock policy. Now, having said that, a no-knock warrant execution may take place in circumstances where it is not a no-knock warrant, but when approaching the execution, exigent circumstances not anticipated by the police officers occurs. You're getting ready to approach the house, and all of a sudden, you see activity which convinces you that there is danger to police officers. You see them running in the house with the gun. You see them through the window with a gun. You hear gunshots. Anything else that you can articulate as to why it now is an officer safety issue, then maybe the knock and announce policy has to be reconsidered. And there's case law that supports that, even if it is not a no-knock warrant. But each of those cases is going to be judged on its own peculiar merits and circumstances. But search warrants are an activity where police officers often encounter weapons. Now, the no-knock warrant also rubs up against some of our other laws, like our stand your ground laws. Under our stand your ground laws, a person in lawful possession of those premises is entitled to reasonable fear of imminent peril or death or great bodily injury if force is being used to enter their dwelling or residence. So if I'm hearing someone breaking into my home, our stand your ground law, Castle Doctrine, gives me the right and a presumption that the people breaking in intend to do me harm. But what if that person is a police officer exercising judicial authority to enter with a no-knock search warrant? Well, the stand your ground law also provides that that presumption no longer exists for the homeowner if he knows that the person entering is a police officer engaged in the performance of his official duties and has been identified as such. There are cases that are in the process of being litigated now that involve warrants being executed by police officers under lawful authority and individuals under the stand your ground rule. So it's going to be interesting to see how those cases work out, but you can see how there's friction sometimes between those two lawful things. All right? Another encounter by law enforcement where firearms are likely to be present. A domestic call. We've talked a lot in here today about domestic violence, and there's a connection between firearms and that as well. Hence the prohibition against possessing after convictions and restraining orders and these types of things. And a lot of times, most of the times, these investigations take place where? In the home. The most constitutionally protected place that we have. So there's again that has to be taken into consideration. Guns and other weapons are commonly present in the home. Domestic calls, when both parties are still on scene, oftentimes is still volatile when law enforcement arrives. That's a two-officer call. Every domestic call is a two-officer call, where there's a cover officer and a contact officer. The contact officer conducts the interviews the witnesses. The cover officer triangulates, again watching for weapons access, close attention to hands and waistbands. There's also a requirement that the parties, when they're present, both parties present on scene, that they be interviewed outside sight and sound of each other. Well, that's kind of hard to do sometimes in a small house, but we do the best we can. So where do we interview these folks? Well, how about the bedroom? Well, you know, that's where a lot of guns are. Well, how about the kitchen? Well, that's where all the knives are. Well, how about in the living room? Well, you know, sometimes people put the guns in the couch, between the couch pillows. So regardless, it's a challenge by law enforcement to carry on this business all the while looking out for where weapons might be located that can be used not only against the police officer but the other party. So it calls for a high degree of awareness in these situations. And again, this is in a highly constitutionally protected location. So, does the party have to notify law enforcement that they're armed, with or without a concealed weapons permit, in their home if police officers there to conduct an investigation? Can a law enforcement officer investigating a domestic call disarm someone in their own home. What about the suspect? Anybody got any thoughts on that? We are in the most constitutionally protected area that we can be in. Yes, sir.
If you're carrying in your house, you're not carrying in conformance with the CWP, so technically you probably don't have to tell them you're carrying one, but I think it'd be a very good idea.
The statement is, and I believe he's exactly right, if you're carrying in your home, you're not carrying pursuant to CWP, and you don't have to disclose to law enforcement. I think you're exactly, but it's a good idea to do so. All right? So here's one way to look at it. And again, every case is going to turn on its own peculiar facts and circumstances, some of, and the inferences of which may be subtle. But if the call does, you know, most of the time when one party or the other complains in a domestic call, they're quick to tell dispatch, he's got a gun. If we get that information, then the officer is on a heightened sense of awareness that there may be a gun involved. If it's simply I won't say simply because it tends to diminish the seriousness, that's not the point. All of them are serious, but if there's no allegation by either party that guns are present, maybe we don't frisk for guns. But if the allegation from one spouse or the other is, she's got a gun, during that investigative process, we may want to, and there have already been threats made, and some allegation of violence, we may want to see if that individual is armed at that time. And if so, take appropriate steps. But again, we're trying to balance officer safety, complainant safety, and constitutional rights all at the same time. And sometimes we get it right, sometimes we don't. So, traffic safety checkpoints. Stopping an automobile and detaining its occupants constitutes a seizure under the Fourth Amendment, even if it's a traffic safety checkpoint. Court says that a roadblock, the purpose of which is for verifying driver's license and vehicle registrations, is permissible, although there's no random searches are permissible. But they say that brief suspicionless seizures at traffic checkpoints for the purpose of combating drunk driving are constitutionally valid, the rationale being the gravity of drunk driving problem and the magnitude of the state's interest in getting drunk drivers off the road. Sometimes the fact that you're conducting traffic safety checkpoints alone will deter people from drinking and driving. Whether we catch you or whether we deter you really doesn't matter to us. We don't care. We simply don't want you harming yourself or others on the roadway from driving under the influence. So, again, we're looking for evidence of impaired drivers. And even though this is a seizure under the Fourth Amendment, it's not unreasonable based on the brevity of time. But the longer that detention goes, the more intrusive and more likely it is will be deemed to be unreasonable. A concealed weapons permit holder arriving in a traffic safety checkpoint knows that a police officer is there and that they've been asked for their license and registration. At that point, a CWP holder is required under the law to disclose to the police officer that they are a CWP holder and that they have a concealed weapon. Again, if you're not carrying pursuant to your CWP, you don't have to disclose a legally present firearm under that circumstances, and passengers the same. So we ask the question again, in a traffic safety checkpoint, can the officer inspect your weapon and run it through NCIC? From my standpoint, the answer is no. I'm not looking for illegal weapons. I'm not looking for anything else. I'm looking for impaired drivers. And if I can't detect initially that I've got an impaired driver or in plain view find something that violates the law, I want to let you go. And the less we dally around with other things, the better. So those are some of the encounters that we are having with firearms and traditional law enforcement. There are many more, and sometimes those encounters involve subtle but important distinctions in the law. We do our best to try to balance that with officer safety and everyone's constitutional rights. So I'm going to turn it over to Craig, and he's going to tell us about DNR's approach and the types of things that they encounter with law enforcement. Thank you.
Excellent. Put this lapel. This is the one that. This one. That's not your. You like this mic okay, or you move around a lot?
I don't know. I'm a little ADD, so I could be all over the place.
If you want to move around, this one will keep you going.
Oh, yeah. All right. Let's see here. All right. Can y'all hear me? Is this, all right, I'm kind of loud anyway. My wife tells me I've got a one-year-old and a three-year-old, so my wife tells me I'm the loudest person that she knows. Everything I do is loud or waking up babies or something. But yeah, it's kind of interesting. I like I said, I spent 4 years as a sheriff deputy here. I was on the SWAT team here in Charleston, worked with Sumter County Sheriff's Office. Then I came out and had a criminal defense practice. So Percy and some of these crew I've known for a long time, so I spent 13, 14 years defending a lot of drug cases, number of murder cases, and that sort of stuff. Then I also represented officers in shootings. I handled up until 2013 when Andy Savage kind of got out of slowed down doing the PBA stuff. He turned a lot of that over to me, so I handled every major shooting with North Charleston, Mount Pleasant, and most of Charleston County up until 2013. And then this job came open with Department of Natural Resources, and I said, I'm gonna let Percy and them make the money. I'm gonna take the less stress, and I exited out of private practice, and honestly, I have not missed it a single day. I have thoroughly enjoyed having time off. I've thoroughly enjoyed the stress level. The few trials that I get involved in are 30-day misdemeanors. Nobody's going to jail unless they tick the judge off. And that's the only way you're going to jail typically is contempt of court. Any of our big stuff goes to general sessions. So I get to liaison with the solicitor, but I don't do any of the heavy lifting. So I have very much enjoyed it. They give me a car and gear, and I get to get out in the field, and I'm going this summer to go tag sharks. We're tagging sharks for this shark tracking program. So I've actually got the dream job for a country boy attorney like me. I love it. I cover the whole state, but it's day trips. And it's neat to get to work with people. It's neat to get into magistrate courts all over the state and work with them. It's a neat job. But it's been interesting to come in because, again, I came from a traditional law enforcement standpoint into DNR, which all of our officers go through the police academy like normal. They go through the 13 weeks. They then go through 6 weeks at what's called Wildlife Basic at the Webb Center in Hampton in the middle of nowhere. I then teach them the DNR law, which this is the Title 50 code book. So DNR law is when I grew up hunting and fishing. I thought I knew about hunting and fishing law. I did not know about hunting and fishing law, and 3 years later, I still don't know about hunting and fishing law. It's amazing what I'll look through, and I'll be like, son of a gun, that's illegal? I need to stop doing that. Or, wait a minute, you can do that? I didn't know that. So there's a mystique with DNR. I hear all the time, well, y'all have the most power of anybody. We really don't have any more power than any other agency. Many of our officers are sworn in with federally, because there is the federal fishing stuff, there is the Migratory Bird Act. The reality of it is, though, is our officers never charge federally, because then you'd have to go into federal court, and that's just way out of our wheelhouse. We're not, you know, we're not going to do that. So if we need to do something federally, I'll call Aaron Brown, the federal game warden, and I'll say, hey, Aaron, come down here. We've got some work. We hate to make you do it, but generally we are able to go out. But there is a mystique that, you know, we have this broad series of power, and DNR, we're policing a recreational activity 90% of the time. So when we hire, we screen very, very carefully. You know, I often have people call me and say, Craig, I heard y'all are hiring. Listen, let me tell you, I'm, you know, I've been on all these SWAT competitions. I'm doing this. I've kicked in a bunch of doors. I'm on the drug task force. And I go, that's great, but how do you interact with people? Because 90% of what we're doing is, you know, educating and dealing with recreational activities. We've got all the police powers. You know, I tell our officers, you've got to keep up all your tactical awareness, because you never know what you're going to run up on. But at the same time, you're out here policing this guy fishing and all, and making sure his fishing license is right, or hunting, and you're driving up to Adelphia where everybody's got a gun, and I can tell you, nobody's getting frisked out there. We're going to talk about how you shoot was, check your plug in the gun, check your licenses, and we're going to roll on our way. You know, so it's a different type of policing that we do. And it's been very interesting, because after they do, again, they'll do the basic academy, then they're going to go do 6 weeks in the woods where they're going to learn tracking, compass navigation. I'm going to teach them Title 50 stuff. I'm going to then go through courtroom stuff, because the academy has so limited that down. You know, when I went through the academy in, I guess, 93, then, you know, you had a much broader court time that you were taught on court procedure and all. Well, that has been narrowed down substantially. So officers, a lot of times you spend a whole week of learning all the elements of CSC first and second and third. You know, one of my things is why do we do that? I don't want any officer going off of any case off of memorization. If you've got a case and there are detailed elements, you need to pull out your check sheet. And I teach our officers, you know, if there's no life jacket on the boat, that's easy. But if it's complicated, you need to sit down and make sure and go through your elements, because, you know, if you're going off of knowledge, and we spend a lot of time, I think, training police officers to learn elements that they're going to memory dump in a few weeks ago, where I'd like to spend a lot more time teaching officers how to recognize probable cause and reasonable suspicion, and how do these work, and how do we build good cases. And I teach our officers, you know, from the foundation up, how do we make and articulate. I tell them, you know, pretend you're taking your significant other out there with you on the job, and as you're going from step to step, and they're going, well, why are you doing this? Well, I can only stop this boat because of this. And well, why'd you do this now? And, you know, and I tell you, that's how you need to be thinking through and articulating through your reports, is if you were explaining it to your significant other, then that's the same thing as me coming out to these to a judge and to a jury's ears as to why you move from this step to this step to this step to this step. So I teach a buildings blocks and just kind of go back through that. We then send our officers to 4 weeks of boating school. So they come down here to Fletsy at the Naval Weapons Station, and there's a federal law enforcement training center where they have a boating school, and people come from all over, and we do a 4 week school where they learn to back boats, and they learn how to put the boats in the water. And if we've got 20 officers, what we're going to do is put two officers on a boat, we're going to drop 20 boats in the water, we're going to have 10 boats who are offender boats, and the officers are going to pair up into boats, and we're going to go out there and act like drunks on the water, and we're going to have seasoned officers out there, and they're going to have to pull us over on a boat. They're going to have to learn how to come up against that boat without cracking the gel cone on the boat and making DNR pay for boat repair. They're going to have to learn how to arrest a person, move them from one boat to the next without getting legs caught in between the boat and breaking up legs and making us pay for legs. And then they've got to actually go in and write a ticket, and then they've actually got to go in and present this in court. And I critique them in court. We actually will bring in a guest attorney to act as a judge, and they've got to go in and actually just present their case and just go through that, just so they get some of a taste of what it's like to step into a courtroom and kind of know what's going on. And Of course, in South Carolina, hunting is a big deal here. It's built into our Constitution, and then in 2011 it was put in under Article 1, and we have put into the Constitution the right to hunt and fish and harvest wildlife traditionally, subject to the laws and regulations that we see fit to be able to appropriately manage wildlife as a resource. And it ties in with that and the way our powers sort of develop, and again, you hear, y'all have a lot of power, you can do a lot of things, and just sort of walking that trail, the wild birds, wild game, and fish are property of the state. And those deer that are running across the property don't belong to the hunting club, they belong to the state. We are conservation officers, and as you go into the statutes, it declares that wildlife officers are conservation officers. So we also have a duty as conservation officers to manage the resource. Talks about, in fact, it is a positive duty of all sheriffs, deputies, constables, and rural policemen, special officers to actively cooperate with the department in the enforcement of game and fish laws. And we team up a lot with other agencies. We're very close. I know our guys in Florence work very close with the Florence County deputies. We work very close with other agencies. We're a relatively, we have, I think right now we're at about 200 and maybe 50, 260 officers statewide. So in the overall scheme of things, we're a very small agency. And we work and depend on other law enforcement resources to assist us in there. And kind of going into our power, we have some unique powers in that we have all the traditional requirements of a general traditional law enforcement, but we also have the powers of inspectors and regulators, which is different. I mean, you think of a building inspector, they can come into your building and inspect the building. They're not looking for a criminal violation. They're looking for some deficiency under a code or some set of regulations. And we are uniquely have that dual role in there, which is much different, because it's not you don't have those constitutional safeguards against the building inspector. They don't have to give you notice to come in or have a warrant in hand when you go to erect that building, or if you want to open up a restaurant. A food inspector can come into there because it's a public safety concern. And we have the same things as agencies. So, and our officers, we try to train and make sure that they understand the role that they are acting under, which hat they're acting under. Because again, when they're acting under that role as a law enforcement officer, there are constitutional safeguards that you have. When they are acting under that role as an inspector, as a regulator, you don't have those same constitutional safeguards, but you can only act as an inspector pursuant to what you're inspecting and what the regulation gives you power to do. We have the power to go into a commercial fishing business and go into their commercial properties and check those and make sure, like DHEC, we have some concurrent jurisdiction to make sure that the conditions under which they are handling those fish in the commercial setting that are coming out and going on to your tables are handled. Are they keeping these oysters at the right temperature when they're being brought in by somebody by a harvester, and they bring them in, sell those to a wholesaler? Well, that wholesaler has a duty to keep them at a certain temperature before they put them on their truck and they ship them down to one of the restaurants down here. If it's a deer processor and somebody's bringing in their deer to get it processed, we have the authority to go into that processor and make sure that they are cleaning their things, to make sure they're putting that deer in the refrigerator like you're supposed to make sure that they are not mixing a deer with a hog, which hogs have a number of different things that are contaminants, and the law requires you to use totally different equipment when you're handling. You can't be mixing up and moving over to use this saw or this particular knife to do a deer that you were just using on that hog, because you can have cross-contamination and there are different ways it's handled. When we go into that place under that, we're going in under the authority of an inspector and a regulatory. And there aren't a lot of law enforcement agencies that have sort of that dual role. So it's a very interesting position that we have, our officers do a very good job, and we do a lot of training on it. I go in, we have a region meeting every month. I go in, do legal updates. So right now we're in the middle of our in-service training, annual in-service training, and we do a lot of training on that stuff. You could see under here, we have, and I have an underline, we have exercise supervision of the enforcement of laws of the state, regulatory, and there's very few other criminal agencies that have a regulatory authority. Your traditional police officers and sheriff's deputies don't have regulatory authority. They typically are handling it under criminal law. And when we go in under regulatory authority, you know, we have to understand that we're not going in under criminal law. It's under 5120 that we are wildlife law enforcement personnel designated enforcement officers, and it goes down and provides that as we are conservation officers and inspectors provided under there. So again, it's a unique role. We have some specific statutes that allow us to go in and enter and inspect buildings or stop and search fishing vessels. And this is typically in the commercial setting. Again, if it's going to come from off of a boat and potentially end up on your table, we have a duty to make sure that it is being handled properly and it's being handled safely to make sure that it doesn't. I mean, if you look at the things on if you've ever gotten sick from eating oysters, you know what I'm talking about. I mean, it's amazing taking this job as I see the dangers with oysters and shellfish and how sick it makes people, and in fact it is something where if you've certain immune systems, older folks or young kids, it can cause death. It's amazing, and shellfish have a very precise way of handling it, because the moment the temperature changes, shellfish in and of themselves, oysters and clams are nature's filter. Things are coming through and filtering. They filter the ocean, which means they can pick up a lot of bacteria. And as soon as that, if that temperature has changed just a little bit, that bacteria immediately begins to cultivate and expand exponentially. So shellfish are something that you've got to handle very, very specifically, or otherwise it can be fatal, but it can definitely make you feel like you want to die on there if you've ever gotten sick from oysters. So it's just very, very interesting to see. We've got a specific statute that says if you're out here fishing, then we have a right to be able to inspect your creel, whatever you're holding the fish in. If you've got it on a stringer, if you've got it in a cooler, we have the authority. We don't have a search warrant. We don't have to articulate that you're doing something wrong. We have the ability to do that. And the courts have said, and I've got some cases later on in here, the courts have said, listen, if you're doing a highly regulated activity, then there's an expectation that you're going to be checked. If you're doing something fishing and we're trying to manage a certain resource, the only way we can manage that resource and make sure that you aren't getting more fish than you're supposed to is for us to be able to look into that cooler. So it's an interesting role that we have. We have a covert team that goes undercover, and they operate all over the state. And they were undercover with a guy. And this particular guy was a commercial fisherman who had a drug habit, and he ended up, he would go, and when we actually went and served a search warrant, in this case, we went ahead and took all the safeguard, did a search warrant on his house. I mean, we found coolers full of redfish that had just, he would get enough redfish to pay for a few drugs and let the rest of them rot. And he had, we had 48 quart coolers of shrimp, and he would take and he would catch them. And this guy was if he had put his mind to doing this commercially, legally, he just knew fish. I mean, he just knew when the shrimp were going to be there, but he would get a 48 quart cooler and he would go and dock somewhere, hide it in the bushes, go back and get another one. And as we began, didn't know, we had inserted a undercover officer with him, but you know, he would have at any one time 4 or 5 48 quart coolers of shrimp just rotting somewhere. And he would just get enough for the drugs and let them go. And again, these are resources that are limited. I mean, you know, it just has an impact on there. But there's actually a statute that talks about enforcement officers, deputy enforcement officers, it can enter onto private property, whether it's posted trespassing or not. There's actually a statute that allows us to enter onto those properties. There's case law supporting warrantless administrative searches. And that's what things like when we check a boat for fishing, if we see fishing rods and we check that, there are numerous cases, and they've been upheld all over the country, that say, hey, as long as you're entering into a highly regulated activity and you're entering into an activity that comes with limits and the ability to go over those limits, we're allowed to search those without having to have probable cause that you are violating that. Now, the courts have said that those searches are limited to dealing with that issue. If you're fishing and we're going to check your cooler for the number of fish, we can't go all through your console. At that point, we're moving out of a regulatory role into a criminal role where we're doing a search that's in violation of the Fourth Amendment. And now we've moved from a regulatory to a criminal. As soon as we move from that regulatory to the criminal, the Fourth Amendment attaches, and we've got to have a reason to be going into there. And that's where we train our officers. If there's some reason to go further than that, you better be able to articulate it. I teach our officers, what I mean by articulated is you better be able to have the words come out of your mouth. Because officers, officers know when something's going on. Anybody in here that's done criminal defense, you can ride through and you can spot a drug deal happening. If you've done criminal work, you know what's happening. Now the deal is I may know it's happening intuitively and based on my experience, can I articulate a reason that I can go and inject myself into that? And the fact that I know it's happening doesn't always mean I've got probable cause to be able to involve myself in it. And that's what I teach our officers is, look, you may know something's going on here, but how do you make that? What are the steps, that let you go from A to B? And if you can't tell me what they are, if you can just tell me I know he's doing something, you're probably right. But you got to roll on because there's nothing you can do about it unless you can tell me a reason why you went from A to B. And if you can, great, that's your job. But if you can't, you got to get them another day and you got to move on. So it's an interesting part that we have, and the court cases have gone. This one in 2011, and I'm not even going to try and pronounce People versus, I think it's Macayo or something like that, but that's a California Supreme Court case that the U.S. Supreme Court denied cert on and basically upheld. A game warden saw a guy fishing from the pier. He saw what looked like a lobster trap coming up, and at that time it was out of lobster season. Again, he was some distance off, but he saw it, and he ended up pulling over the vehicle, checked the cooler in the back of the truck, found the lobster. The person, they ended up going to court saying it was an unreasonable search. The court came down and said, when you're fishing from a pier, you got to have a fishing license. It's a regulated activity. We don't care whether the officer, and they said from that distance he couldn't really tell whether it was a lobster or whether it was a fish. The court said, we don't care. When you engaged in this highly regulated activity, you are going to the officer is allowed to be able to follow up on that and make sure you are complying with the regulations. It's not a criminal check at that point in time. It's regulatory. Now, our officers, the way that we train our officers are, I mean, if you see a guy riding down the road with fishing rods, you can't stop that vehicle. I mean, that's not enough to draw a nexus between the regulated activity. Now, if they're on their boat or they're pulling, coming out of the landing, that's a different story. And you got fishing rods in the boat and their boat water's dripping off the boat and they're pulling out. If you can stop them there, that's a regulatory check and you can check that cooler. But if they're riding down the road, that's outside. There's too many people that are riding down the road. Maybe they're not going to fish till next weekend, or maybe they're had their boat, loaned their boat to somebody else. That's too much of a jump to be able to step in there and stop that person in that circumstance. Federal and state courts have overwhelmingly held up the administrative searches. Now, the one area they have is the closer this becomes to a dwelling and curtilage, the courts have said that's not all right. We don't have any power to go into your house. We don't have any power to go into your yard other than the normal power that anybody else would have. I mean, we can certainly walk up to your house and knock on the door and say, hey, listen, we want to talk to you. We heard you might be out, shooting this deer or whatever, and it might be here. And if we don't have a search warrant, you say, don't want to talk to you, slam the door. You have that exact right. We don't have any more power on the curtilage and on your dwelling. And the courts actually came out and said an ice shack, and I think that was up in Minnesota, is close to a dwelling. People stay in there overnight. We don't have the right to go into an ice, not that we have a lot of ice shacks around here, but said that you can't go into an ice shack. That is closer to a dwelling, and you have an expectation of privacy that we cannot overcome in the regulatory arena. This case is a Fourth Circuit case. It governs, and people ask, well, what about if they come onto my property, not my curtilage, but I own a farm or I own a hunting property. How are y'all coming onto my hunting property? The courts overwhelmingly, there's also a Tenth Circuit, Sixth Circuit case that have come out in the past year that have said the same thing. Open field doctrine, we can go on to your property. We cannot go into your curtilage and into your dwelling, but if you've got property outside of that curtilage, then we can go on to that property because part of managing that resource, the deer, ducks, quail, whatever it may be, part of that is being able to go on there and make sure that it is being hunted within the rules and as per the regulation, the only way we can do that is to go on there. And the court said, in fact, we can go on there and we can put a camera onto your property. And we can set up cameras on there and it happens not regularly, but there are circumstances, you know, we'll find a lot of times after deer season, deer and turkey season, you cannot bait turkey. You cannot put out corn on there. Well, we will find corn piles on there, and usually we're tipped off on this 9 times out of 10 because the odds of us just finding a pile of corn without having some tip off is pretty slim. We're not, you know, with 230 officers and some off, some on, we don't have time to just be walking around property randomly, thousands of acres, looking for corn piles. But generally, we're getting a tip. And we'll go in there, we'll find a corn pile, and we have every kind of camera you can think of. And we'll put those up, and invariably, we'll catch the person coming on to there, and we will then, and the courts have said, it's perfectly fine for us to put a camera up onto your property. And that's been, again, that we're two cases, the Sixth and the Tenth, that were upheld, Sixth Circuit and Tenth Circuit this past year, and then this case up here, which is in your materials. And some of your materials are a little bit out of order. I changed it up a little bit more, I hope, to make it flow a little smoother. Who knows if that's happening, but nonetheless, y'all get what I'm saying, I think. But the Fourth Circuit said we can come onto that property and you know, regularly, you know, I have people call them and say, hey, I met one of your guys today. I'm like, well, where'd you meet them? Well, they were in my hunting club, and they just walked up on me, and they're very nice, but can they do that? And I go, they can do that. So it is kind of interesting. These are two cases that are, this is a 2016 case at a private farm. It doesn't have to be a hunting club. A private farm is not curtilage. If you've got a farm, we can go on to that farm. We can go into the pastures. We can do that for the purposes of we don't need a warrant. That is not curtilage. That's considered open fields, even though it is a farm and it's not your curtilage. This other case said that an open field need not actually be a field. It can be woods. So, and most of you know that, but it doesn't technically have to be an open field. That was argued in an 84 case. Well, this isn't really a field. This is woods. These are pines. And the court said, well, that's a term that we use. But what we mean is really anything other than your curtilage. You know, firearms go hand in hand with hunting and with you know, it being our state having such high hunting. If you look down at the third line on this graph, you know, you kind of, that's our firearms related numbers. In 2013 we had 15 non-fatal firearms related hunting accidents, 3 fatal. 2014, 16 non-fatal, 1 fatal. 2015, 18 non-fatal, 3 fatal. In 2016, non-fatal, 3 fatal. And I'll tell you, most of the, and I was trying to think if there are any other scenarios, but those are either ones where an individual has, we have somewhere they have dropped their rifle from a deer stand, and it has gone off on some occasions. Most of those where there was a firearm is where a person did not identify the target, and they shot at something that was moving, and it turned out to be a person on there. And that's what happens a lot. And the other ones on here, you know, and it sort of changed the way that I hunt, you know, the way that I think through with what I do, and our club have some safeguards set up, so we haven't had any firearms issue. I'm in a hunting club out in Ravenel, but falling out of tree stands, how many of those we have, and there are certain types of tree stands I've just quit using. I don't use the old just lean up, the ones that have no sides anymore. It's amazing how many. You know, I get a text every time there's a call out, and it comes onto my phone, and I'm on standby if they need me for whatever. But firearms, there's an inherent danger with that. There were 14 firearm-related accidents for 2016. The statute that our most severe firearms-related statute that we have that is specifically under, and we can enforce any firearm-related statute, but the one that we... That is our most serious is the negligent discharge of a firearm. And this is what we would typically would charge in the case of a hunting accident where an individual has shot somebody because they didn't identify their target. Again, if they identified their target and then they shot them, that's murder. So what we're talking about, again, is the hunting accident where it truly is. So there's a negligence, a criminal negligence standard in here. And we get that. We just had one just recently where an individual shot at a deer. He's a new hunter, was very straightforward on this, but missed a deer. He was shooting a .308, which has the capacity to carry for a long distance, and it did, and it went. The deer was probably about 175 yards. He had a very cheap scope on the gun, and when he fired, the round actually, he missed the deer and must have shot way high, and ended up, it lodged in the inside of a garage of a house about another 250 yards beyond that. And I will say it is very, very rare that we have circumstances where a house is hit, cars are hit, those sort of things. Again, overwhelmingly, it's a situation to where there are two parties on adjacent properties and one doesn't know the other one's there, and you got a person that's right, and most of these happen right at dusk, where it's very difficult, it's dark, and they really don't have the optics to bring in the light that they need to, and they see that movement where they know they've seen deer there before, and for whatever reason, they think that, I think that's a deer, and they fire, and they find out it's the hunter from the next property over who is whatever is happening. And I mean, we've had some extremely tragic circumstances. We had one down in Horry County where a young girl was hunting and she had taken the safety off. She was climbing up on the four-wheeler and had the gun by the barrel, and I can't remember, I think she, when she stuck it down, something caught in the trigger and discharged and shot her there. And I will say most of them are avoidable. Most of them, you know, it's just a matter of if it's kids, a lot of times parents have just gotten too relaxed. And if it's in adults, it's just typically a matter of, and again, this job has probably made me overly cautious. I mean, it's just I just see so much, and I see most of it is avoidable. But this is what we would be charging under. Again, if there's no injury, there's no property damage, it's a 30-day misdemeanor. It's going to come into magistrate's court. If there is property damage only, it's a 6-month misdemeanor, but it's going to go into general sessions court. A number of our charges we have been working on getting what's called concurrent, well, most of you, if you're judges and all, and y'all know, concurrent jurisdiction with general sessions and magistrate's court. I mean, a lot of our stuff really probably is better suited to be a magistrate's court. The reality of it is a lot of our stuff going into general sessions is going to get very little traction. It's just not something that's normally in the solicitor's office wheelhouse. And the time it takes, a lot of time for them to kind of get up to speed on it, when they can move a drug case in or something else that they normally handle. So we prefer to handle as much of our stuff in magistrate's court as we can. It goes on up to where there's a death for, must be in prison for not less than 3 months nor more than 3 years. Typically there's a fine associated. There's also suspensions of hunting privileges. Again, for a hunter, that's a significant thing. But that going into hunting, we are one of the few states that do not, and I think, I'm over, Steve.
You got about 4 or 5 minutes.
Okay. Anyway, we're one of the few states that really don't define hunting. So what I would say is, if you are a defense attorney or if you are a judge, when you get a case in, look at the statute, because we have some case law and everything is in your materials. But one, look at the specific statute that the person is charged under, because what we do in a number of our cases, in a number of our statutes, is we define hunting different depending on what the what the actual act is. So certain things, if your gun is unloaded but the ammunition is within 30 feet, you are deemed to have possession of a loaded firearm, and in certain circumstances you are hunting. In other circumstances, if your rifle or shotgun has to actually be loaded and have one within the firearm. Others, it doesn't have to be loaded, just has to be within the reach. So if you've ever got questions, I get calls regularly from attorneys, defense attorneys call me, judges will call, and they'll be like, Craig, some of our stuff, and forgive me if there are any legislators in here, y'all do a great job, we appreciate you if you are here, but some stuff is not drafted as clear as it could be, and it's been amazing for me to get there, and I got invited to go hog hunting last year, and I was like, well, let me just double check, because it was, and we've got a very convoluted law that may get simplified later on, but we have our hog hunting statute is, there are a number of things, and it's in the materials just to kind of illustrate what I'm talking about, but under certain one of these statutes, for hunting from a roadway, it's, you got to have a loaded centerfire rifle or a loaded shotgun, but you've got to have a shot size larger than number 4. I don't know how many cases I've had with road hunting cases where our officer rides up there like, Craig, I got him, I caught him out on the road, I got this, and I'm like, well, okay, well, you know, what size shot did they have? I don't know. I'm like, but that's an element. I mean, you can't not know on there, because the problem is, like I tell them, is we can't move forward, because first thing they're going to do is say, you know, defense attorney's going to say, well, Your Honor, you know, I never got any discovery that says what size shot it is, because if it's smaller than that, well, then it's not road hunting. And so going through that, and so if you get these cases, look at the statute, because it's not as clear as you think. And a lot of times, I mean, I've had one's attorney call and said, well, Craig, you got my guy. And I look and I'm like, we probably do. Let me check. And then I find out, well, crap, we should have your guy, but we don't have your guy. And your guy got a break this time because we did this. Or sometimes they call and they say, you don't have my guy. And I go, well, did you check this? We got your guy. And they're like, crap, you got our guy. So look at our stuff. You can call me anytime. You know, there are points that are involved. There are mandatory suspensions that are involved. This is not every firearm, but this is the ones that you'll see the most. We have a hunter education program that goes through different things, and I recommend people take it just to be educated on some of this stuff. We have programs that are in schools that are there to educate on some of these things. They're not in every school, but a lot of schools now have these things where our officers go in and teach the basics of hunter safety and some basic functions with firearms and those sort of things. All this stuff is online. You can contact me anytime. Like I said, I talk to judges, attorneys, defendants if they're pro se. Anybody that knows me here knows I'm pretty straightforward. I'm going to do what I need to do, but I'm also very straightforward, and I can, you know, most attorneys call me most of the time. They know they can, if I can work with them, I'll work with them. And but anytime I can answer something, or if you've got any questions, and appreciate y'all letting me come this year.